So the presentation is divided in two sections. In the first section, I will present, let's say, the motivation why to address to TDFT, and then the general time-dependent density functional theory. In the second part, rather, it will be devoted to linear response TDFT, while tomorrow there will be presentation on the beyond the linear response, so non-linear response by Valérie Beignard, and finally also using an approach which is even more general, relying on general TDFT, a real-time, real-phase approach of TDFT. Okay, today, so we are focusing on the general TDFT and the linear response, and on the linear response TDFT, I'm going to present also some results, what you can get from linear response TDFT. So before to start, I would like to frame, let's say, the whole school, because this refers to also to other lectures we are going to have in the next days. And I would like to, let's say, to in condensed matter, in practice, condensed matter, it's a very well-established field in the sense that, for example, the interaction is very well known. It's not like in high-energy physics, in particle physics, where you can have interaction to still to be discovered. Here, the interaction is electromagnetic, exactly like in QD. So in principle, the physics is already there, the problem is already solved. But in practice, this is not the case, because in condensed matter, we have the so-called many-body problem. Many-body system consists in many constituents, atoms, nuclei, electrons, all interacting. And this is what is called the many-body problem, which is already present in classical physics, if you remember. For example, in gravitation, you have the so-called free-body problem. If you have in gravitation just only two bodies, so the Sun and the Earth, you can calculate analytically the orbit of the two bodies. While if you have free body, the problem is already it becomes already a problem, which has been taken, for example, by Euler, Lagrange, historically. In quantum mechanics, even two bodies is already a problem. So you know that, for example, in the hydrogen atom, you can solve the Schrödinger equation in an analytical way. So you can have the closed form analytical solution of the hydrogen atom. While in the case of the helium atom, which is a two-body problem, because quantum mechanics is a two-body problem, because we are considering quantum mechanics just only the electrons, not the nuclei. The nuclei is classical to describe the atom. And this is the Hamiltonian of the helium atom with the kinetic terms of the two electrons, the interaction of the two electrons with the nuclei, Z, and then the many-body problem. And this is already an Hamiltonian which presents a Schrödinger equation which is not possible to solve like the hydrogen atom in an analytical way, in a closed form. Just only know numerical solution of this equation. More generally, so in a condensed matter system, you have the two, again, the kinetic and the electron-ion interaction term for n-body, in this case, and this is the problematic many-body electron-electron interaction. You see that in the case of a general condensed matter system, the Schrödinger equation is a Schrödinger equation in which you have to calculate the many-body wave function, which is a function of n space variables, and this n can be up to the Avogadro number, so 10 to the 23, like in the lecture of Gianmarco you have seen. So even the wave function is an object that you cannot treat because it's too difficult even to write on a sheet of paper. Not to talk about the fact that this equation can be or not solved. But you see that the problem, as already illustrated by Gianmarco, relies all in these terms, because if you can neglect this term, like it is done in the so-called independent particle or independent electron approximation, then the Hamiltonian can be factorized as the sum of n single particle Hamiltonian. You can solve the Schrödinger equation, the single particle Hamiltonian, like in the hydrogen atom, and have the solution, so the wave function energies, and then you can write the wave functions, the total many-body wave functions, the product antisymmetrized, like in the Slater determinant of the single particle wave function, and the energy is the sum of the single particle eigenvalues. Okay, so there is no problem if you can neglect this term, and this is indeed what is done, for example, in the Ashcroft-Mermin textbook, which is the textbook of many solid-state physics lectures. You can see that already neglecting this term, you can do a lot of physics. However, this approximation has limits, and in fact, you cannot consider this term is smaller with respect, for example, to the electron-ion term, because the protons and the electrons have the same charge, so the source of the electromagnetic interaction is charge. If the proton has the same charge of the electrons, well, of course, you cannot neglect this term with respect to the interaction with the protons. Okay, so it's a very formidable problem, this many-body problem, and historically, physicists, theoretician in condensed matter physics, decided to take all this problem following two different paths. In one path, physicists decided the problem is too complex and decided to address rather to simplified models, in the hope to find analytical solution to this model, like in the case of the hydrogen atom. Here I list the most important models that you can call the Anderson model to describe impurities, in particular the Hubbard model to describe the many-body, the electron-electron interaction. All this model, the drawback of this approach is that in this model you have just about parameters, and you hope that this model, simplified model, in many cases really toy models, these models still are grasping the main physics of reality and adjusting the parameters on the experimental reality. You hope to describe the physics of the system. In the other branch, physicists on the other side decided that to renounce, to give up for the analytical solution and rather searched for a numerical solution. So this relied on the power of computers. So really the hope of the SECAM, the institution we is hosting us, but still addressing to the microscopic Hamiltonian, so not a simplified model, but the real Hamiltonian, the real physics of reality. And here I list, let's say, the most important microscopic ab initio first principle. These are really These are these refer, contrary to model, here you can really refer to the microscopy. So they are really ab initio first principle. There are no adjustable parameters on the experiment. The most important are, for example, the quantum chemistry approaches. So you have seen with Gianmarco full CI, couple cluster, two other methods. Then also I list in this branch also quantum Monte Carlo that can solve have the possibility to solve the microscopic Hamiltonian, so without adjustable parameter. And finally, density functional approaches, density functional theory, TDFT, and many-body Green functional approach. The drawback here is the fact that in most of the cases you have to rely to resort to approximation, like for example the local density approximation in DFT. So and these approximations are out of control. You cannot judge, for example, in LDA, it's not like in a perturbation theory approach. In QED, for example, you can stop at the first or the second order, and also at the third order evaluate the error. So say this quantity is 2 plus or minus 0.01, while in the case of approximation, non-controllable approximation of Bayesian theory, you cannot quote an absolute error for your prediction. Okay, so now why here, of course, in this school we are lecturing on ab initio first principle theory, in particular on density functional like and many body Green's function like theory. But why it is important to why we need ab initio theory? Because it's only by ab initio theory that we can understand, explain, observe the phenomena. In fact, a model always contains a conjecture, and maybe that the conjecture is wrong. And by adjusting the adjustable parameter, you adjust, let's say, tricking the situation. You are just masking what is reality by what you believe is a faithful representation, which in fact could be not a faithful representation. Then, by ab initio theory, is the only possibility to offer experimentalists reference data before the experiment is done. And the third point is the most important. Only by ab initio theory you can predict properties before the experiment is done, because by models you need to adjust a parameter to the experiment. So it's something that is a post-processing approach after the experiment. And these are the purposes of this European Theoretical Spectroscopy Facility, which is financing this school. Okay, so now you have seen that there are many ab initio first principle theories, and the first question we can ask is which ab initio theory for which properties of spectroscopy? Each theory can describe a part of physical property, quantity observable, but every theory has a limited extent, and this is something that you should be very well aware when, for example, addressing a particular observer or particular experiment. And to this purpose, it is better for the theory we are describing in this school, it is better to divide to split the condensed matter properties into two main files. What are called electronic ground state properties and the electronic excited state properties. So in this first branch, you have the ground state total energy, the atomic structure of the ground state. Again, you can describe the phase stability, the ground state electronic density, and other observables, in particular also phonons. Phonons, you may imagine that are rather excited state properties. But here we are talking about electronic ground state properties. Phonons are excitations of the ionic degrees of freedom, not of the electronic degrees of freedom. So in this sense, phonons, I write phonons into this part rather than the other. While for electronic excited state properties, I list the electronic structure. So for example, the bump plot and the band gap is an excited state property, or the Omolungo gap in molecules and finite system. And so also because the metal or insulator character depends on the band gap, also is a so the character of a solid where metal, insulator, semiconductor is an excited state properties. And then spectroscopy, like for example, the optical spectroscopy or dielectric, like energy loss and so on, and other quantities. These are really electronic excited state properties. Now, you all know density functional theory, and density functional theory so is in principle X theory that can describe all the electronic ground state properties. So all these quantities, the atomic structure, total energy, electron density, and also the phonon frequency, as I told you before, are in principle can be in principle exactly described by dense by exact this theory, exact density functional theory. And this refers also to strongly correlated systems. So on this quantity, DFT, exact DFT, DFT is an in principle exact theory to describe, for example, the atomic structure or phonon frequencies or the electronic density, also strongly correlated system. And here I present you an example called this is vanadium dioxide. It's one of the first systems that Neville Mott himself declared as a Mott insulator. So what you can consider as a prototype of a strongly correlated system. And here a calculation of the lattice parameters using DFT, LDA, using nonlinear core correction or semi or including semi-core orbitals into the valence and the pseudo-potential compared to the experiment. You see that these are correctly described by DFT. Of course, let's say this is true for exact DFT. Now, the fact that you had to use an approximation, in this case, local density approximation, means that you make an error on these quantities. And typically, LDA has a 1-2% error in the 99% of the system. So there are some systems that are not correctly captured by LDA, but this is the fault of the approximation, not of DFT. In fact, here I show another system, helium atom, for which we know the exact numerical solution up to 40 digits. Okay? It was possible by, let's say, standard method solving the standard Schrödinger equation. And here you can see that, for example, the DFT LDA result present an error which is 2% with respect to the exact value. GGA improve, so is able to reduce the error down the 1%. But then in this system, we were even able to touch this, let's say, somehow untouchable exact DFT, because in the case of the helium atom, since we have the exact solution, we were able to do a kind of reverse engineering to calculate have the exact exchange correlation functional, the exact exchange correlation potential, Kunshan potential of the theory, and use this potential to calculate all the exact DFT quantity. And in this case, you can see that, for example, it is possible to calculate the exact DFT, like it has been done in this paper, and you see that you get really the exact total energy of the system. While other methods, like for example, FuCl, present also some error. And the same also for variational Monte Carlo, which present a bias, while diffusion Monte Carlo is in principle, is in principle unbiased, and so you can in principle the most you run, the closest you the most of the digits you get of the exact solution. So this was an important example. Yeah.
GW plus BSE.
GW plus BSE. Okay.
Does BSE change energy?
Sorry?
Does BSE conversion change energy?
No, I don't understand your question. What do you want
So
to?
a different like
Okay, different. Yeah, it's
BSE.
okay. I have to explain now to calculate this GW plus BSE. Maybe after the lecture by Francesco and Laura, I can tell you how I calculate it. However, you can already imagine what is the meaning of the free approximation.
I mean, with GW, yes, I have different energies.
Yeah, right.
But
My GW is an approximation.
BSD, I don't get it.
Okay. No, there is a way to calculate the total energy in the framework of BSE. Okay, we are not going to explain in this pool, I think. But if you like, after the Laura lecture, I can tell you an idea how to calculate Bethe-Salpeter total energy. We can calculate also GW total energy. But all these are approximations, like LDA. And so you have to expect an error with respect to the equilibrium. But you see, here you already see, for example, but you can imagine, for example, what is the non-interacting total energy. What is the non-interacting total energy in this case? Oh, in this case, you neglect completely the many-body term. And so,
It's the BSE can extend the approximation.
exactly. So this is, let's say, the energy you will have if you, for example, if you like in the hydrogen atom. So if you replace in the hydrogen atom, what's the ground state energy of the hydrogen atom? How much is it? Louder.
One is electric.
13.16.
One is better, no? Okay, so one half R3. But if you remember, in the hydrogen atom, the energy is E equal Z, the other N E, like this. Okay? So one half in R3. Okay? And so for the helium atom, you have to, so here is Z squared. So for the hydrogen atom, this is equal to one. And for the, no, it's not like this, it's not like this, okay? If I remember. And so for the ground state energy, it should be four. Okay? And then you have also the R3 energy. You see, you go in the right direction. The R3 Fock is not that bad, not that bad. Okay? And then, okay, for the other approximation, at the end of the school.
Yes, just a quick
Yeah.
question. Regarding this exact DST that you mentioned by this paper, you said that because we have a hint from this exact solution, we
Yeah,
can
exactly.
estimate the actual correlation.
Right.
Is there any way to, I don't know, using machine learning, for example, to do this interpolation for estimating better exchange correlation for more complex than?
This is an active domain of research, very active domain of research. So they are using a machine learning approach to use an example to try to. We have the exact exchange correlation potential somewhere, the helium atom, the hydrogen molecule, some model systems. However, it's, let's say, the data set is, I would say, reduced. We would like to have a much more exact solution in order to cover the realm of condensed matter physics. But however, this is one, so they are not doing it with the exact solution, rather, for example, using quantum Monte Carlo is a good idea.
And this exact solution is available so far, hydrogen and helium.
The analytic solution is available just only for the hydrogen molecule, and even for the models. So let me say that even the models, people, model theoreticians, they hope to get the analytical solution of all these models. But for example, for the Hubbard model, the solution is known only in 1D, not even in 2D. This in spin model, after a huge effort, is known in 2D up to the Onsager solution, not in 3D. And so, for example, for the upper model, they get up with searching the analytical solution, and rather they address it again to the numerical solution, like in ab initio. And this is the dynamical Mifid theory. Dynamical Mifid theory is a way to provide a numerical solution, not an analytical solution, which is much more valuable. Okay, so we don't have not even exact numerical solution. Also, definition of numerical solution is very precise in numerical analysis. And there are few systems. So just only this Hilleras approach is able to provide a numerical solution up to the not even diffusion Monte Carlo can be considered a numerical solution. I could enter into the details, but these are mathematical aspects. Okay, so we don't have not even numerical solution. So the machine learning can be applied on approximated solution as well. Okay, so. So DFT can predict in a principle exact way all these properties. Now DFT has limits, and DFT cannot predict all the excited state properties, so the electronic structure, the bank up, the character of all these properties are beyond the limits of DFT. Of course, and here I show you the case, for example, again, for the helium atom, where we have this exact exchange correlation potential. And you see here that it is the homolumo, experimental homolumo gap. Here is the DFT LDA homolumo gap. There is a 30% typical underestimation also in this case. And then you can calculate the homolumo gap using the exact exchange correlation potential. This is the really real exact exchange correlation potential giving this exact DFT total energy. But you will see that you miss completely the experimental band gap. So even if you one day you are able to find this dreaming exact exchange correlation, you won't have the band gap. Not the homolumo gap of the systems, okay? And this is the proof. Xavier Gons calculated this homolumo gap.
If you included the derivative discontinuity.
No, if you, okay, yeah.
It's not
the Conchamp gap. No, this is the Conchamp gap. Also, another. So you can calculate the band gap in isolated systems, doing the difference of energies, like Gianmarco told you. But this you can do just only on an isolated system. So on the helium atom, you can do this, and you will get.
In delta SCF, you mean?
You mean in delta SCF. By delta SCF, in the helium atom, you can get. But the Conchamp, the homolumo gap between the highest occupied and the lowest unoccupied Conchamp eigenvalues for exact DFT is this one. So you see is again underestimating the experimental value. Why Artifoc is giving you a better result and GW is improving with respect to this. Okay, so don't dream that the exact exchange correlation function is the solution for every your problem. The excited state properties are outside the realm of even exact DFT. Okay, so which ab initio theory to use if DFT is not valid, and for
Excuse
which
me?
Excited state? Yeah,
I don't really get intuitively why Hartree would work, but not exact.
But Artifoc is let's say an in principle in Artifoc. There is a Koopman theorem holding that tells you that the Artifoc energies can be interpreted as quasi-particle energy, so as energies to remove to add electrons to the system. And so thanks to this theorem, you can use Artifoc to have a physical prediction within an approximation. Because Artifoc
contains an approximation. You write the solution, the artifact solution, in terms of just only one Slater determinant. You neglect correlation. And so this is the solution of, that you can obtain within the approximation to neglect correlation, okay? To only search the solution on only just the one Slater determinant. You see that it's not that bad. So correlation is this small part that can have an effect in some system. Or for example, people claims, strongly correlated this artifact. Also, pay attention that in solid state physics, the reference theory is DFT, DFT, LDA, PBE, whatever. So those who are saying that this is a Mott insulator because DFT, LDA predicts it as a metal, in my opinion, this is not correct. You have to do an Hartree-Fock calculation of the solid, see if the Hartree-Fock open a gap, and then if this gap is not close to the experiment, or so in that case, you are not allowed to say that this is a strongly correlated system, because Hartree-Fock is the, by definition, the approximation that neglects correlation. So if Hartree-Fock is close to the experimental result, means that correlation in the case are small, not strong. Why? Today, people refer to DFT-LDA and thinks that in DFT-LDA, in reality, there is some correlation because you have a correlation function, you see. So Hartree-Fock is not that bad, in particular in isolated system, while in solids, and Gianmarco has shown you the figure showing you the band gap, in solid Hartree-Fock strongly overestimate the band gap normally, can be even 200%, while DFT-LDA is underestimated by 30-40%. So in this case, in solid, DFT-LDA is closer to the experiment. Okay, so Hartree-Fock is not that bad in a solid system. You can evaluate it. And so for this problem, so the Homo-Lummo gap, and now we have to, let's say, establish which ab initio theory to use. And in this sense, I invite you to split again excited state properties into two categories, charged excitation and neutral excitation. So neutral excitation are excitation in which the system undergoes a transition in which, for example, you push an electron from the valence band to the conduction band, but the electron is still in the system, so the system undergoes a transition. Neutral excitation transition, the total charge is not changing. You are simply pushing, moving charge from one place, from one state to another, from one place to another. While in the case of charged excitation, like for example, sampled by photoemission spectroscopy, you inject an electron into the conduction band, or you, for example, like in inverse photoemission, or you remove an electron from the valence bands. So the charge of this total charge of the system is changing. Why I am doing this difference? Because from the point of view of theory, it is different to describe these two kind of excitation. In particular, if you have to describe charged excitation, you just only have to take into account the electron-electron interaction. While in the case of neutral excitation, you have to take into account the electron-electron interaction plus the electron-hole interaction, for example, in the case of optical absorption, optical spectroscopy. And this make a big difference in the theory that you have available to describe this excitation, because time-dependent density functional theory can only address neutral excitation. While if you are interested to charged excitation, so for example, to photoemission, you have to rely to many body theory approaches, like for example the GW approximation. And also you can use these approaches, this Green's function approach, also to take all neutral exponents. So this theory is much more general than TDFT. In TDFT, you can only describe neutral excitation, neutral spectroscopies, and which are these neutral excitation, neutral spectroscopy. And here a reminder of the spectroscopy from the first CIMO lecture. So you can describe optical absorption, optical spectroscopy, like this. So like in this. Crude setup, but today optical spectroscopy is measured by ellipsometry, a much more indirect technique. And in optical spectroscopy, you sample in particular electron hole single particle excitation, exciton excitations. And these are the, so the optical spectroscopy you can take on by TDFT, in particular the optical absorption, the Nordenschlager spectrum CIMO reddish review, like also the refraction indices, like in the Aspnes-Tudor experiment here, the reflectance, all the formula for this quantity that be already you can find in the lecture of CIMO. And then you can also describe the so-called dielectric properties, like for example, energy loss. And it is the same of the elastic X-ray scattering spectroscopy. They are both measuring the same quantity, the inverse of the dielectric function times a constant, which has been presented by CIMO in the first lecture. In both this spectroscopy, you sample both single particle exciton excitation, but in particular collective plasmon excitation. And so this technique, unlike optical absorption, is more sensitive to, and this is important. So the sensitivity of this spectroscopy to the various excitation is important at the time to establish the correct approximation, as we will see later. Okay. And so in TDFT, you can address energy loss in elastic X-ray scattering spectrum and other more exotic techniques that you can ask CIMO if you have some questions. So now I think it's better to stop here before the first part took a little bit time, I wonder, but let's stop for a coffee break and resume at 11. Yeah, 11. Yes. Okay.